We are live.
I'd like to call the meeting to order and acknowledge that we are in Treaty One territory, the home and traditional lands of the Anishinaabe, Ojibwe, Innu, Cree, and Dakota peoples, and the national homeland of the Red River Métis. Our drinking water comes from Shoal Lake, 40 First Nations in Treaty Three territory. I'll introduce the panel members. I'm Marcel Larondo. I'll be chairing. Gail Anderson and Bill Mazitsky are with us on Zoom. We're all on Zoom. And Darren Ducharme is our assessor. The recording secretary today will be Belen Rojo. To the Zoom participants of the hearing, please note that you are placed in the waiting room until your property is called upon. When it is your turn, you will be admitted into the meeting. Kindly follow along with the City of Winnipeg's Board of Revision YouTube channel for the hearing process. Once the host admits you into the hearing, please close or mute your YouTube player. You will then be permitted to speak with respect to your property. Once your hearing has concluded, you can leave the meeting. We'll be hearing applications for revision of assessment rolls in accordance with the Municipal Assessment Act. The matters for which revision is requested have been described in each application, and we will limit the discussions to those matters. The statements that are made at this hearing are sworn testimony, and anyone speaking to the matter must be sworn in. Be advised that comparisons of assessment of properties are not considered evidence of market value by the Board of Revision. The Board of Revision is appointed annually by Council and is independent of it and the City Administration. It makes its decision on the basis of the evidence provided at this hearing and issues a written order that will be mailed to all parties as soon as possible. Please note that the Board's decision with respect to an application may be appealed to the Manitoba Municipal Board if the matter pertains to assessed value or classification, or the Court of King's Bench if the matter pertains to the application of exemption from taxation. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included with the board order. With respect to the hearing process, I will confirm the points of appeal with your property to be addressed with each applicant following the swearing in. We will then have the assessor's testimony followed by questions, and the applicants may have, and then the applicant's testimony followed by questions. Each side will have an opportunity to summarize if they wish. Once all the evidence about an application has been brought forward, the applicant may leave. The process will repeat for each item on the docket today. The session will close after all applications have been heard and the board will deliberate in private and make its decisions. You will receive the board's decision by registered mail as soon as possible. As information, all public hearings are live streamed, recorded, and will be part of the public record. We'll be hearing items 1, 2, 4 through 8. On the docket today. Ms. Rojo, please confirm the assessor and the applicant's testimony.
Madam Assessor, please state your full name.
Morena Gantika Demada.
And you affirm the evidence you're about to present is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Assessor, please state your full name.
Darren Charles Dujar.
And you affirm the evidence you're about to present is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. Madam Applicant, please state your full name.
Diane Schindelman.
And you affirm the evidence you're about to present is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, it is.
Thank you. Mr. Applicant, please state your full name.
Justin Gregory Zarnowski.
And you affirm the evidence you're about to present is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you so much.
Okay, we're starting with item number one on Kaler, I guess we'd call it. It's for assessed value. If the assessor can read on the information, please. Do you hear me?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. File number 22/67675. Roll number 12097809130. Property owned by 3346234 Manitoba Limited. This is a vacant commercial land. This land lot size is 488,762 square feet. It's located in the Taylor, along the Taylor Avenue, facing the external road. Page number 2, you can see where the property located. If you can picture it. If you know the area, it is adjacent to the Walmart, Taylor Walmart. You can see the bottom picture where it's located. And that that vacant land facing an external road. It's not facing a Taylor, but it's facing external road. This property has the I want to tell you the story because this is a long story. This is a big lot. In 2020, that lot is not exist. We have the entire lot. We call that for Grand Park Pavilion. This lot is the part of the development. Schindelman and me know we did a 5 or 6 replots. It's a long story. That's why I'm presenting today. This land lot divided to this big lot divided to 5 small lots in last year, 2020. Then we created this small lot. Considered this is a small lot from the big lot. It is facing internal road and adjacent to the Walmart. You can see the pictures. Right now it's not developed. It's ready to develop, but it's not developed. It's service land, but it's it's the ground covering is the grass, and it's a vacant commercial land, truly vacant commercial land. Page number 4, you will see my rent comparables. Rent comparables within the city, it's not very close, but we cannot say it's a very close, but similar type of developments. Sage Creek Boulevard, it's those lots are facing external Sage Creek development roads. 70 Bison Drive, similar type of location, a similar type of development. And St. James Road, Northtown Road, it's very similar type of vacant land lots. You can see the rental rates. It's vary from $16.14 to $28.43. But today, for this property, and also this property has another feature. If you go page number 3, the bottom picture, you will see the hydro lines going above this land lot. When we do, when I review this property for the Board of Revision, I decided to make a recommendation to reduce the value because original value went out model driven, and that model driven valuation does not count the hydro line running above the land, because it's running not above every entire land lot. It is running about small area. It's a 2013 square feet approximately affected by hydro line running about. That area allowed to build the parking lots, not allowed to build the higher volume buildings, but those are allowed to build the parking lots and those are allowed to build the roads. But below those lines is all of the developments covered by the either road or the parking lot. Considering those factors, I'm making a recommendation to reduce the value to $7,087,000 today using $14.50 land rates, because our original land rates were $19. But today I'm asking to reduce the value based on $14.50, which is lower than comparable land rates, because comparable land rates does not have that problem with the hydro land running above the part of the land. But other than that, all the comparables somewhat similar to the Grand Park Pavilion this lot. You can see pictures of the comparables in page number 5, 6, 7, 8, Those are all my comparables. Okay, I think I should go one by one. You can see the stage break development comparable, page number 5. This is also not facing the main road, but facing the external road, internal road, I mean. Bison Drive and St. James. It's page number 7 is the St. James development. Page number 8 is North Town. Page number 5 is the North Town. Page number 10 showing Ness Avenue comparable. Those all comparable stay higher than recommended land rates, but recommended land rates based on the negative impact on hydroland. Based on those, my evidence presented today, I'm asking to reduce the land value for this property for $7,087,000. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you for that. Our applicant today is, who's here? I'm the applicant, I might have missed that.
Diane Schindelman and Justin Saranowski.
Okay. Who's going? Diane, are you, I've got to ask, are you accepting the recommendation?
No, we are not.
Okay, I had to ask that question. Have you got any questions of the assessor?
Yes. Good morning, everybody. Regarding the comparables, would you say that those comparables have since are able to be developed?
Ms. Schindelman, I cannot hear very clearly for some reason. I think it's your mic.
Okay. Hello?
Again.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll stand a little closer. Of all of your comparables, are they able to be developed?
Yes, those are.
Have they been developed?
Some are.
Do they have any other restrictions for development on those lands?
No, that's why we make a recommendation to reduce.
And are they all on frontage? Do they all have frontage?
The most of them are facing the internal developed road lands. You can see the best one, I can say the North Town Road. It is not facing Kenniston. It is facing the internal road network because it's the Center Road, North Town Road, and all of those roads. Those are exact same thing as the Grand Park Pavilion Road Network. It's internal roads.
Those would be roads that have traffic lights, and all of those roads would have traffic lights. And
North Town Road has a traffic light, but not the Center Road or anything. It's all residential kind of linking roads. Those are not the major roadway.
Okay. Sorry, one second. The sale dates, you had trouble finding some sales closer to the reference year. They're all quite, a number of them are quite far away from the reference year.
Of course, yes. It is really hard to find the very close reference years. But if you think about those are far away from the reference year, they are per square foot value is higher. But If we find that something very close to reference here, per square foot rate may be higher than what we presented here, I can find it.
And if we go comparable by through each comparable, you'll see, would you say that they're developed with the highest and best use? The first comparable, I believe, is developed with multifamily and some retail.
Our first comparable, it's a mixed use.
And the second comparable is developed with? Looks like multifamily to me in the picture.
Yeah, I think it's a multifamily. It's not the mixed use, it's the multifamily.
And the third comparable is retail by Polo Park.
Yes.
And the fourth comparable is developed with retail, and it would be grocery anchored.
400 is, yeah, because the same one food you might mention. It's the same with the your Polo Grand Park Pavilion with the Walmart. Walmart is the higher anchor tenants than the same one food. Major, yeah.
And the sixth comparable is looks like it's developed with multi-residential.
Our sixth one. Smith Avenue. And it is a continuous one.
And it looks like these parcels of land were pretty much 100% developed, like the full parcel was developed. It's like from
those comparable are being developed.
I don't have anything else.
So are you aware that the city has said that this land can't have a building on it, that there isn't adequate sewer capacity?
Okay, I will tell you the story. This is a long story. I think me and Ms. Schindelman talk about this one very lengthy. You know exact 100% truth behind this story.
Yeah.
I talked to the water and waste planning department to know about all the information, because I really, really want to know what is the exact thing happening with these ones. Those are service lands. Those are ready to build. But if you stick with the 2014 master plan, those are buildable. No problem. They are buildable. They are not. They are buildable. They are ready to build. But as per their explanation, because the multi-family units were building, it is using more than what it's supposed to use as a water and waste amount, because it caused the problem in these other lands. But if you can develop any multi-family development in those lands, but it's ready to build as planned in 2014, any CRU units, in those lands. Those, they don't have any problem with giving approval to build the commercial units, but they have warned the owner, they have warned the architect, they have warned everyone to not to cause trouble for your own land, not for overusing the water and waste capacity. That's what's happening here. So it is a long story. I don't have to do much explanation about Ms. Schindelman. I explain why the problem is and what's the problem, because this is the big, if we consider vacant commercial land, this is the truly vacant commercial land, because we cannot consider this one is the unbuildable land or undeveloped land or anything. This is available in the marketplace, and we need to consider the market value. But I'm really, really happy to do the adjustment for hydrolands, because it's a true problem. It is, you cannot build any building underneath the hydrolines. Our model does not have any capacity to identify those hydrolines. That's when we entered the data into the model, we cannot have any adjustment to make for hydro lines, then we today I do all the adjustments to make a recommendation to using hydro lines and using other negative effect to make a value to reduce. That's why I'm making a reduction on that value. That's a long story. I try to be very short. I think that's all I can answer this question.
Well, why don't we make it even shorter? Would the city let us build a building on this land?
They are allowed. You can build the land, buildings on this land as long as you stick with the 2014 master plan. You cannot change, because if I have a land, because I cannot change the plan for every time, because it was, there is the approved plan, you have to stick with that plan. That's what city is saying.
So, but you realize though, with the apartments that were built up front, which are being assessed separately, like that's not this parcel, that the city is currently saying, you can't build a building here. Are you aware of that?
I know everything because I talked to the board and waste project people. I know because owner is causing problem to this land, because it's the problem with there. If you overuse the water and waste capacity, you might get into the trouble, because the city was water and waste warned the owner. They send enough notification for the consultant, and still, as per the email you were forwarded to us, owners forwarded to us, it showed very, very clearly saying owner has to stick with the original plan. That's all I know. And I know more detail, but it's, I think this is enough to make a decision on this property.
Well, but you haven't answered the question. Like, what existing right now, the apartments exist. You said you talked to water and waste.
You can build
the building. I'll ask the question. If we apply for a building permit, will we get one?
Yes, you do, but you have to stick with your original plan.
So if we knock down the apartments up front, then we can build. That's what you're saying? Like, you say stick to the original plan, but yes, you know, those are concept plans that change. They have changed, the market changed. So right now, if we applied for a building permit, would we get one on this land? That's the question, yes or no?
You do get one, you have to stick with your original plan.
So if we knock down the apartments, okay. I guess that's all we can get. We'll deal with it on our evidence.
We'll let you put that all in your presentation.
Thank you.
Gail, do you have any questions?
My question to the assessor is, just to confirm what I have heard you say, if I understand this correctly, I just want to make sure I understand that the owner could develop the property in accordance with the 2014 original master plan, so could develop commercial retail space there, except for the portion where there are the hydro lines. You can't put a building there and you can't have parking lot there, right? Like, you can't develop a period.
You can have a parking lot, but you cannot have the buildings, because if you're building a building, it has the building restriction, height restriction. That's better usage for that area is the parking, because that's the exact same thing for the Walmart development, because Walmart built in the clear area, parking lot building underneath the hydro lines. That's I think that's the original plan was that's happening, and that's the
okay. So there can be buildings, but the original master plan provided for retail commercial buildings, is that correct?
That's okay. Yeah, you can see my rebuttal, the pictures and everything.
Okay. Okay. And so your adjustment is to $14.50 square feet. That's what you're proposing as an adjustment to recognize that undevelopable property.
Yes.
That could only be used for parking lot. Okay. Thank you. That's all my questions, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Bill, do you have any questions?
Yes. So, on this property with the hydro lines, if you go to page 3, on the right side there, there's the hydro line, correct?
Yeah.
And now they don't seem to continue on across the property. I can't see any lines going across from that one pole on the right side. Does it turn or something? What happens there?
Now that pole you're looking at is a crane.
No, there's a hydro pole over to the left side there, right?
Well, that's on the other side of the tracks.
You are referring to subject property photo, or is that page number 3?
Yeah, page number 3.
Okay.
On the top picture.
Okay.
Not on the bottom picture, the top picture.
Okay.
You know what my question is then?
Yes, I know. I know the question. I tried to find out because I think we don't have a better picture here. It's hydro lines going across, and it's the mostly on, you can see the road lines.
Bill, the lines do go all the way across.
It is not going across the hydro poles. It's just the hydro lines. It's really hard to explain to me those hydro lines. But when you see my rebuttal, you will see the better picture of how the hydro area effect, hydro line affected area. Those are identified 4 or 5 years ago. Then that picture is not in these briefs. That's the problem.
Well, you mentioned your rebuttal. Is that another document?
I think that picture is actually including my rebuttal and including applicant's briefs too. You can see it's the color-coded area, and we talked about those area long ago. You can see those ones clearly. It's not the hydro only lines. It's kind of hydro has the restriction caveat to put about not to build this kind of higher buildings on the area.
So what percentage of the land then is affected by the hydro lines?
Okay, I need to do the calculation. If total area is affected. Okay, total area for this property is 488,762. Affected area is 213,363. Give me 1 second. I can tell you the percentage.
Well, I don't need to know the exact percentage. It's about half then, right?
It's not a half. Yeah, it's a little less. It's a 30. It's approximately 30%.
30%.
Yeah, approximately. It's not. I tell the numbers without calculating. Just seeing the numbers.
Could you repeat the easement area? Because I got 43.6%.
Okay. Yes, 43 times 6% is the exact number.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I did the math now.
What is it then? 43%?
43.6.
Okay. But it's affected by hydro area.
All right. So you mentioned the original plan 2014. Is that attached into your documents here or anywhere?
Original 2014.
Yeah, the original plan you mentioned a few times, referred to it. Oh, is it in
your presentation? No, we don't attach here. Actually, this brief not prepared by me, but some plans are missing here. But you can see the rebuttal evidence for the actual area.
The rebuttal evidence?
Yes, but I'm not, because of the rebuttal, I'm not going to talk right now. But yeah, you will see the exact picture in there.
All right. So how did you, okay, you want to reduce it because of the hydro lines.
Yes.
You came up with a figure of $14.50. How did you come up with that? What was your
rationale
for reducing it by $5?
Okay, because if we consider full amount, value went out approximately $19 and some cents per square feet, times the clear area and half rate on the hydro affected line, and I came with the average and give the another $1 less for the all the problems I'm hearing here and there. That's how I came with the value. It's the full rate on the play area, half rate on the affected area, and $1 less from the average for the considering challenges. And also, we have an agreed value for this property, $13.50 from 2018, as my memory is correct. When we talk about these rebuts for long, long ago, I think 7-8 years ago, and also for 2018, when we do the supplemental value for those ones, we came up with the value for the landlords. The value we used $13.50 for the land, for the excess land. That's the exact same thing I'm basing on this last cycle. That's the rate we use for excess land. And we give the little bit of higher adjustment for the $14.50. No exact science how I came with the 14 cents. The based on average, based on what we agreed for the last cycle, that's how we thought about the $14.50 would be the appropriate for this cycle.
Okay. I have no further questions, Mr. Chair.
Okay, I do have a couple. Number one, the master plan that you keep referring to, are you going to be presenting it in your rebuttal?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so we'll see it then. My second question is on the rail line, did you allow any loss of land for that?
Rail line, yes, we did. That's how we came up with the 488,762. This already remove the rail line, what we call the area.
How much easement did you allow for that?
I honestly, for this cycle, I did not check, but we did this work for the couple of years before when we do the river.
But you didn't present it in today's evidence.
But it's already dealt with. Because the rail line does not have any negative effect right now, because it's the rail line right away area is reduced from this 488,762
square feet. Okay, I'll see what goes there. Let's move on to the presentation from the applicant, please. Diane, are you presenting or?
I'll probably touch on the capacity and servicing, but Diane can then go through our brief first.
Okay, I got to get your first name again.
It's Justin.
Justin, that's what I thought. Thanks, Justin. So you're going to go first?
I'm going to go first.
Or is Diane going? Okay, go Diane.
Okay. So this is file number 675.
Correct.
Page one, as in general, the property has significant impairments due to the hydro easements, the rail setbacks, and the sewer capacity. Page two, I hope you have this in color. Do you have our brief in color?
Yes.
I do believe we do.
Okay. So on page two, you can see the 11.2 acres or the 488,000 square feet and in yellow, and then the sort of gray shaded area, which is kind of a grayish yellow, that's where the hydro easements are on page two. And you can see that this property is not fronting on Taylor. It is actually right along the rail line. And it currently doesn't have any access roads to it, although there is a road along the center of the whole development. Page three, you can see as an aerial where that land is located, not along Taylor Avenue towards, but along the back of the development. The hydro easements and the overhead lines don't allow us to build any buildings, as you heard before, but there's also significant cost to go along with the hydro lines above. We're responsible for making sure that they're not damaged while we're developing the property. And we have to pay for curbing, fencing, and boulders all around the hydro infrastructure. So not only can we not build anything around them, we have to take care of them ourselves. Regarding frontage and visibility, again, this parcel does not front on Taylor Avenue. And it is located behind a six-story apartment building. So the visibility is significantly reduced from 2018, the last cycle. Railway requirements, the setback requirements is 30 meters for this property. And so we would not be able to build anything within 30 meters of the rail line. This is enforced, of course, by the city, and so that reduces the amount we can develop on that property. Pages 4, 5, 6, 7 is an article explaining how the setback is required, and so I'm not going to go through all of that. It just confirms the 30 meter setback from our main rail line. And it also indicates on page 7, there's about 40 to 50 trains per day along this rail line. And so that also impacts what we can do with this property and what tenant would like to go there. We also have to try to mitigate noise and vibrations with berms and various other construction remedies to make it more able to be developed. Okay. On page 8, we were talking about a change that has happened since 2018, back when at the last assessment cycle. So it's the sewage capacity. I'm going to read this line by line to try to explain the significance of this. The Water and Waste Department of the City of Winnipeg has advised that they will not approve any plans for new development on the lands west and or north of Walmart. They have said that the apartment buildings under construction have used all of the sewer capacity, which was allocated during the rezoning process for the lands. As such, no building is currently able to be built here other than what currently exists or is under construction. As such, the market value for this land is virtually zero, except for long-term speculation that the city may resolve its capacity issues in combined sewer districts. It is worth noting, that temporary measures such as septic tank or field are not permitted.
And so to explain this issue, when you apply for a rezoning, the city makes you guess on what you're going to build. So in 2012 when we started the process, we put together a site plan. At that time, we thought retail was still going to be strong enough that we would be able to do you know, a Walmart and be able to do a bunch of retail here. We were wrong. And frankly, on these rezoning applications, we're almost always wrong on the site plan because things change. So as the market shifted, we decided to build apartments. And so what has since also happened is the city and the province have been fighting about sewer runoffs in combined sewer districts. And so the city's solution, at least to date, has been to try and restrict any new development anytime they can, so as to, I would say, probably pressure the province into paying to help fix the issue. But whatever they're thinking, they're saying, oh, well, you know, if you showed a site plan that only had X square feet or X amount of toilets, we're not going to let you build anything different. You're set in stone in 2014. That's not how it used to work. That's not the understanding by which we prepared this site plan. Otherwise, we would have just pretended like we were going to build high rises and showed that on a site plan. So we took the city's word for it. This is a concept. It's not a master plan. It's a conceptual servicing plan that they're relying on. And what we said was, okay, the market changed. We should build apartments. We want to invest in Winnipeg. And the city said no. Ultimately, we were faced with that information from the city. We chose to build the apartments because we think the city's interpretation of their development parameter bylaw is incorrect and that we should be able to submit a new servicing plan. But we haven't gotten there yet. And the city continues to say, we'd like to build a 6,000 square foot building in this area, and we can't. They won't let us put literally an extra toilet. So to say, oh, well, this is your fault for building apartments, well, it doesn't matter. If we can't build anything, the land's not worth anything. So today, that's the reality. If the city came back and said, we're willing to let you build something, yeah, I mean, we wouldn't be at this appeal. And we'd be really happy to pay property taxes as if this could be developed, but that's just not the reality of what. So one city department saying we can't build anything, and then we have another city department saying, but we're going to tax you as if you can, is frankly absurd. But that's the roundup on the sewer issue.
Diane, are you done, or is Justin just cutting you off?
I'll continue. So like Justin said, we cannot build one more toilet on the site. So it would be pretty difficult to develop this land without a toilet. Maybe that makes it clear, a little bit clear as well. On page 9, I show some sale comparables of some land, which again, I mean, it's completely difficult to find sale comparables to go with this situation we have. But it's like we have undeveloped land or unserviced land. So I have the for sale comparables. I did them in price per acre, but if we wanted to see them in price per foot, the first one is $468 per foot. That was a nice square parcel on the corner of Sturgeon Road and Selkirk Avenue that sold for $468 per foot in 2020. $1420 Waverly. Fronts on a major street, Waverly, and was sold in 2018 at $11.82 a square foot. That's the conversion from this price per acre. 5429 Robland Boulevard has a little bit of frontage on Robland, which would give it an access to this property, to the property, and it's $13.70 per square foot. And then I also show a parcel in Bridgewater, which is, as everybody knows, a very strong retail multi-residential area right now. And that one sold for $15.49 per square foot. All of these parcels are a fraction of the size of the subject. And so again, these values would be higher for that reason as well. But these are all developable pieces of land. So like I said, it's impossible to find a similar situation that we have. On page 11, we submit that the value is between $200,000 to $300,000 per acre, which would be $4.59 per square foot to $6.89 per square foot for this property. Page
Page 12, the appendix is just some emails from Tim Shanks from the City Water and Waste Department explaining how we cannot build another toilet or build anything with a toilet on this land. So if we look at page 12, he said, Tim Shanks in his first email says, if only this single apartment is built, then theoretically it could be accommodated, but only if all of the development on the rest of this lot is restricted to keep under the wastewater total originally identified in 2014. Well, things have changed since 2014, so we cannot do what he has said. And then if we go down to skip through some of the other emails, although you're welcome to read through them. On page 15, it says, Water and Waste Department has reviewed the updated technical memo and it's sufficient for currently proposed apartment block at 1110 Taylor to proceed. Please note that based on all the information provided to date, the total permitted flow of approximately, I'm not sure what those technical numbers are, in the 2014 servicing report will comply with our provincial license requirements for the overall site, but that further increase in flow will not. So that suggests that we cannot build anything else. Future development would need a revised updated servicing report to demonstrate compliance with our license limits, but of course we don't have that.
Well, and more to the point, you can't provide it. Because an updated servicing report that doesn't increase wastewater would be an updated servicing report that has no other buildings on it. So it's the same thing. You can't there's no way of like retaining sewage flow on site. With rainwater, you can, you know, have it be in ponds and things like that, but you can't do that with sewage. So there's no way to reduce your sewage flow. And that's fundamentally the issue we've had. So what they're asking for is impossible without saying we're not going to build anything else.
That's my evidence, our evidence.
Okay. Justin, were you completed on it as well?
I am, yeah. I jumped in the middle, but it's a little harder when we're not sitting next to each other.
I know. I'm finding it difficult myself. Okay, I'm going to come to questions. Madam Assessor, you have some questions?
Yes, I do. Thank you. Page number two, you are in page number two.
Yes.
Because 11.2 acres for your plan does not include the railway setbacks, right?
That's the full land. We still have to do the 30-meter setback from that.
Okay. In the city plan, when we do the, do you aware, when we do the report, we just consider that setback for that for the landlord to calculate the landlord of 488,762 square feet. In my rebuttal evidence, I include the picture, aerial picture. It shows the property line. It does.
You know
what?
I'll let you talk about your rebuttal when you present it, because you haven't presented it yet. You keep talking about it. So let's get away from your rebuttal until you present it, please.
Okay, sure. Thank you. Okay, I'll leave that question later. Page number nine.
Yes.
If you don't overuse the sewer capacity for building in other land lots, do you believe your all comparables are similar to your subject property? If you don't overuse the sewer capacity?
Well, no, right? They don't have frontage. They're not next to rail lines. I mean, for all the other reasons, sewer capacity aside, you know, this site's still behind a six-story apartment building. It still has a rail setback, which is calculated not from the rail line, but from the property line of the rail right away. So that setback still exists on this property and doesn't in the Bridgewater and doesn't on St. James Street. So
I mean,
there's no other issues.
Excuse me, I only talk about the overuse of sewer capacity. Railway line, yes, of course, railway line behind that, I understand. But if you overuse the sewer capacity, you can build the buildings as the other comparables. I only focus on sewer capacity. Because
so I don't understand the question then.
Okay, because that's the big 1,000 Taylor lot. When we divide 2,000 Taylor lots for five units, five small lots, but some lots overuse the sewer capacity. If you don't overuse the sewer capacity in total development, can your subject property also similar to the comparables?
Well, no, right? Because you have a setback from the rail line. You have the hydro easements.
Sewer capacity. If the sewer capacity, here is the biggest problem. It's not the railway line, not the hydro line, because we consider the railway line and we consider the hydro line to make a recommendation. My entire question about the sewer capacity. If you don't overuse the sewer capacity, you can still build the buildings on your property. Like the comparables, yes or no? I'm just asking yes or no.
I mean, the idea that we've somehow overused sewer capacity is absurd to me. But yeah, I mean, if the city said we could build buildings there, then we could build buildings there. Yeah, obviously.
Sorry, I'm so sorry to disturb you, but your presentation clearly tells because market change, we decided to use the multifamily and we decided to use the entire sewer capacity. That's why we cannot build on those ones. Is that problem created by the owners? Do you agree?
No, it's the city. The city is misinterpreting the development procedures bylaw to say you know your concept plan is set in stone. That's wrong. That is not an accurate description of how our development procedures bylaw works, not how servicing agreements work. So to say we did something when it's the city that's making a mistake, no, I can't agree to that, and I won't. The only reason we're saying this is worth anything and not nothing is because we do think eventually the city is going to say, actually, we were wrong. You can build something here. But years of fighting and waiting, and that's the issue. It's the city is making a mistake here. And eventually you'll fix it. But who knows when eventually you'll be.
I understand what you're telling me. But I'm an assessor. I am here to value the property. I only can consider the facts for the value of the property. I don't know about the other departments, but I do call.
Madam assessor, is this a question you're coming to, or are you debating him on something?
Yes. So I want to know about this. I'm seeing this one as a vacant commercial land. Is it still the vacant commercial land?
It's zoned for commercial and it's vacant.
Do you consider this is a vacant commercial land?
Didn't I just answer that? Yes, it's vacant and it's zoned for commercial.
Thank you.
Bill, do you have any questions?
Yeah, on your appendixes there, I didn't have a chance to read through those and I really can't do it while we're doing this meeting. So what I would like one of you to do is to point out exactly where the city says you cannot build anything on that land because of the sewer capacity.
Yeah, can we realize this as we were pulling off the emails that it isn't, if you don't understand the jargon, it isn't that clear. But if you look at the email, it's my email exchanges with Tim Shanks, which is appendix page 12. What they're talking, the thing that you should most carefully look at is if only this single apartment is built, then theoretically it could be accommodated, but only if all other development on the rest of the lots is restricted to keep under the wastewater total originally identified in 2014. What they're saying there, so wastewater, they do it by outflow. So how much actual sewage is coming out of the site. They're saying, if you build this apartment building, we think that you're not going to be allowed to hook in another toilet. And so when they're saying development on other lots, this is one of those other lots where they're saying they're not willing to do any more development. So that's the clearest that the city, these are engineers. So everything's very technical, but that's where you should draw your attention to them saying no more development.
And also on page 15, where it says in the second paragraph of the last email there, it says, but that further increases in flow will not be approved. The paragraph starting with, please note.
But
that
am I understanding it correctly that you can build one building then on this property?
Sorry, I can't hear you.
Am I correct in understanding that you can build one building on here then to a certain capacity or not?
No, so we can't do any additional wastewater flow, which means you can't do a single toilet and you need toilets to meet code. We couldn't build a shack here. You couldn't put a single family house on this 11 acres. Is the city's current position.
Okay. And you're waiting for that to be rectified before you would go ahead with anything on the land, correct?
Well, yeah, I mean, we hope one day somebody will retire and somebody better will come in, I guess, is our current course of action.
Now I've got water problem. You didn't have, sorry, can I?
Sorry, I was just going to say, in the foreseeable future, we cannot build another thing on that site.
Okay, just one more question. And I don't like using hypotheticals, but I think in this particular case, I have to. If you didn't have that water, the waste problem, you would be able to develop this land in a satisfactory level that you're satisfied with?
Yeah, I mean, and we would.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the only thing that's really holding you back on this then, is that issue. You can get around all the other ones.
Well, I mean, the hydro easement is what it is. It's big, and but yeah, I mean, fundamentally, we could site plan around that. It still impacts the site for sure. But in terms of doing something here, yeah, I mean, we're in the business of building stuff. We'd like to.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and then you have a conclusion page where you say what you think the value should be between $2,240,000 and $3,360,000, correct?
Yes.
Okay, no further questions.
Gail, do you have any questions?
just along the same line, just to understand, like going back to the original concept plan, and I know that, as you're saying, that wasn't, you know, in stone from the developer's perspective, this is a concept plan that we're taking forward to be rezoning. Am I correct that six-story apartment building then that is in front of this property, that wasn't part of the original concept plan, and that was built? And we issued a building permit to be built. Is that correct?
So yeah, it was in a different spot. We had always intended to do residential here. It was why our zoning includes residential, but we moved it from, I'm gonna call it the back, the southwest, southeast, and moved it up front because we had intended to build retail in front of Walmart. We thought that's where people wanna be. You know, you're gonna wanna have a hair salon there, all that. And it hasn't, like I said, hasn't played out. So we liked that better as an apartment site, being right on Taylor. So we put the apartments there.
Okay. And so that was contemplated, not in that exact spot, but that was contemplated, that size of a residential development in the original concept plan.
I mean, the city had actually approved, it was 600 to 800 units was what we had told them. It was in our master plan. So makes this all the more frustrating that we currently have 248 units there and no more capacity.
Okay, so no more capacity for sewage, despite not filling just to say quota of what was designated as residential, multi-residential properties. being developed.
Exactly. In the planning documents, yeah, we had 600 to 800 units.
And there's 200 and some now.
248, yeah.
And the one that you're wanting to build on this property that you cannot is about the same size?
So the apartments sit on 3-acre sites with no, like that fit well with hydro kind of around them. So, I mean, you could conceive of doing more here, but the site's a bit of a different size. It's at the back. So it wouldn't be the exact same of dropping just doing it in. We need the yes, you can build something before we can figure out what that is.
Okay. So couldn't even build a retail store.
No.
Okay. So the proposal that you have for a reduction of what you've proposed aligns with it being an unserviced property.
There's almost some value, Diane, built in there in the faith that I'm going to be able to win this argument at some point.
Okay.
It's probably, those values are probably more than an unserviced property, but we want to be realistic. I do genuinely think sanity will prevail at one point.
Okay, thank you. Those are all my questions, Mr. Chair. Thank you. Thanks, Justin.
Justin, you've talked about the concept plan that was developed in 2014, correct?
So it was submitted in 2014. We would have been tinkering on it from 2012, 2013.
Okay. It was approved when?
Let's say 2014. Like I think January 2014, but.
Now, the wastewater flow from the original concept, when did you reach the max? After you did the 248?
Yeah.
Did you realize it was that close when you did it?
Yeah. In fact, that's what the emails that are in our brief are arguing about. Is they're saying, well, we're only going to give you this building permit for the second apartment based on you understanding that our position is you aren't going to be able to build anything else.
But your original concept had 600 to 800 units of residential.
I don't know how far you want me to get into the weeds. That we have we have sewer capacity on the other side of Walmart.
Yep.
Which is nonsense. It's all the same pipes. It's all the same site. How the city decided we have a bunch of sewer capacity on one portion of a contiguous parcel and not another one is another frustrating element of this. But because we had shown the apartments in the, I keep saying at the back, adjacent to Pembina, that's where we have capacity, even though it's one servicing system.
You're saying it's all on the same line?
We have 19 lots here. But it was one parcel that we subdivided and rezoned all at one time. So the city's wastewater department's opinion is, even though these are all going into the same pipes and it's all us and it's all the same development, there is capacity for wastewater if it's on the east side of Walmart.
Okay, and how much development is on the east side of Walmart at this time?
There's none, but we're looking at doing a flex built, like a industrial style building. About 50,000 square feet. We just had to wait. There's a pond there that was a temporary drainage pond while they were putting in they call it the Colburn-Calarossi pipe. So they finished that pipe. And so what we wanted to do is screen any future residential from the Walmart loading because it's 24-hour loading. So we're putting like that kind of industrial style like they have it on Keniston. It's like office industrial. So we're doing a building there.
Okay, so this apartment that you're built, it's not built yet, is it? It's under construction?
So we have two apartments. One's almost done. We'll call it done by the end of the month, end of next month. And the second one's about a year behind.
And they're both included in the 248 units?
Yeah, so they're the exact same building, two 124 suite apartments.
And these were the ones that you were originally planning on putting on the other side of Walmart? Closer to Pembina.
Or something like them. Like we just showed a block. These are L-shaped. But yeah, generally that was where we had intended to do the residential.
But the Pembina property was, the other portion was not part of your concept plan for this site.
No, correct? It was one servicing plan, one rezoning, one site plan.
Well, it was all one site plan. Okay.
You try to explain this in a way that makes sense is difficult because the city's position doesn't make sense. So I'm doing what I can to be sympathetic to what they've told me. But fundamentally, we disagree with how they're dealing with this.
Well, I'm trying to figure out how they're coming up with their sewer capacity for the whole unit when they're splitting it off between two and one's not reaching the max.
Being as sympathetic as I can be, the city processed it in three. They visualized it as three separate parcels. It's not. There's land east of Walmart. There's the Walmart site, and then there's the rest. I don't know why they did that. We didn't tell them to do that. So in their mind, there's capacity on the one side, even though it's all the same system, all going into the same pipes, and then there isn't capacity, and you can't move anything. It's absurd, but that's fundamentally what they're saying, is you can't move. Like capacity makes you think of a pipe size, right? So you're like, how can one have capacity and one not? What they mean is they're already on writ large in the system, they're over capacity. That's why you see sewage discharge into the rivers. Yeah. And so what they're trying to do, the Water and Waste Department, and there isn't general guidance from the city to not do this. So they're just saying anything they can do to prevent more wastewater flow into combined sewer districts, they'll do. Who cares about property taxes? Who cares about the value of private land? Who cares about anything? And so that's where that's the tension we're stuck in, is they're trying to prevent wastewater discharges into the rivers. And because they don't have the money to create new infrastructure, or the city council won't allocate money for new city infrastructure, their only lever they can really pull is not allowing development for whatever reasons they can come up with. And that's where we're stuck here.
Did I read somewhere in this information that there was a plan to put in that extra sewer?
They did. They did separate the sewer. The issue is that it didn't create enough. It didn't pull enough out of the combined sewer. So they still have to do other measures. So the Coburn-Cobrossi pipe does help. But the province told the city, stop putting sewage into the rivers. You have to stop.
Yeah.
And that Coburn-Cobrossi pipe isn't sufficient to create a situation where they can have no discharge. They need a bunch of other infrastructure and a bunch of other combined sewer districts to prevent that discharge. So as a kind of stopgap, the Water and Waste Department's just saying no new work.
Okay, so with the land on, but they did give you the permit to put, they gave you a permit to build it.
Yeah.
And then after they've given you the permit, is that when they gave you this letter saying that can build it, or did they give it to you after that?
No, it was before. Like we knew that this would be a fight we would have with the city. So before we got our building permit to build the second apartment, they said, you're not going to be able to build anything else. And that's the email that's in our brief.
Okay.
So we knew, but we, and I told them, I was like, we fundamentally disagree with your position here, and we'll resolve that later, but we need to build this apartment building. We've got guys like who are on site ready to start. We're not building it.
Okay, I'm covered off on that. And I think we've got to go back to our assessor. I do believe you've got a rebuttal.
Yes, thank you.
Assessor?
Yeah.
Do we have a copy of it?
Yes, it has been distributed.
Where is it? Meeting. Where is it on the?
So if you refresh your OneDrive page, it will load. There are three items, and they're at the end of the first item.
1 second. Reloading.
It's labeled item 1 and 2.
Docket. On the very top where it says docket November 28th, no.
So it goes in numerical order. It's at the bottom of item 1.
At the bottom of item 1. Okay, yeah, I see that. Everybody else got it now? Or is it just me?
Is it, yeah, so item one and two, that's the ones that we want?
Is that the Taylor Development Master Plan?
It's a one.
That's one.
I left them how you numbered them, one, two, and three.
Okay. Everyone has the evidence, three but evidence, one, two, and three. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so we start with the first one.
Okay. Even though I numbered one, two, and three, I'm not going to talk everything. I just send the information because everyone might not familiar with what is the Taylor Development Master Plan. Taylor Development Master Plan is the 2014 Master Plan. It has lots of information. It's wanted information and unwanted information, but I did not go to alter anything. You can see how they plan for 2014. The most of the time, as my understanding, this is the plan they started focusing on for development on the Grand Park Pavilion. Our two subject properties, even today I have to present another Taylor property. I'm not going to talk anything because this presentation is enough for the both files. Those both are the part of the Taylor development. Grand Park Pavilion development, part of the Grand Park Pavilion development. This is the master plan for the Taylor development. You can see details if you wish to see it after, but I'm not going to talk a lot about that. We talked enough about the Taylor master plan. The other one is the City Council committee meeting minutes. I include this one to see the pictures. If you go to my second evidence, and page number 11, you can see how they actually plan out for how this development should be and could be. And based on the plans, page number 11, I hope everyone find it, that page. Yeah. Okay. And you can see the Walmart development and all the other CRUs and facing Taylor to multi-family development, facing Taylor, Scotia Bank development, and all the other development facing internal road network. It is the proper, I don't know how many people are familiar with going to the Taylor Walmart. Everyone know it's a very properly designed roundabouts and roads exist there, but those are the internal road network. It's all the other CRUs facing those network. And also hydro line, underneath the hydro lines, you can see all the parking lots underneath the hydro lines. That's how it's planned to develop. It's no problem. We all agree. And that's how planned to develop. That's how it's shown in the plans. And it's page number 11. I'm talking page number 11. From 12 to other pages, it will show the pictures and the maps and the unit plans and everything. I don't think I need to talk everything there. That's how it's supposed to build and plan to build and propose to build. And I'm moving to page number, evidence number three, rebuttal evidence number three. The first page, sorry, it does not have the page numbers, and everyone can see no cover page, first page. That's the city plan for the original Taylor, 1000 Taylor lot plan. You can see orange lines. You can see big building in the middle. That's the Walmart. That's the bigger building is Walmart. And you can see the parking lot. And you can see the setback from the railway line. It's the orange line. it does conclude the 30 meters the area when we put the railway orange line. That's how we in our department plan showing it. We consider that's the railway line setbacks. This is from our system. And my page number two, the next page, you will see adjacent to the Walmart, that's the lot we were talking about. You can see that lot. And also you will see the what's the land area in there. And my page number three, the exact plan Ms. Schindelman used, it will show the total area affected, clear area and affected area. You will see the yellow lines and the gray under gray cover. It's exact same plan because we exchanged those plans for many years. We used those plans for many years. My page number, next page is for the other lot, but I'm not going to talk about that lot right now, but it's everything we talk for this lot also affected. And 2022 balancing figures, this is something very internal document. We usually don't give those documents for anyone, but I include here to show how we divided big land lots to small land lots. You can see all of those information here. This is a very internal document. We call it Thousand Taylor before. Now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 addresses. Some two lots were developed, one for the Walmart, the other one for Scotiabank. Multi-family lot is 90% completion of the multi-family. The other ones are vacant land lots. The other, all of the lots we are talking today, it's in was before it's Thousand Taylor. None of those figures are not the valuation. Those are balancing figures. Don't wait for anything. Give the weight for the numbers here. Those are the balancing figures. But the value is there. This Thousand Taylor property in 2020 assessment cycle, we value for $40,229,000. That's the property we divided to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 lots. When we do the replots, the two lots we are talking today, the lot, one lot we already talked, the other lot we are going to talk in a few minutes. That's my rebuttal. And I put the board operation order also. It's just for information to show it because this is the one row number before it we call Thousand Taylor. It's a value for this Thousand Taylor. It's so much different than the value we present, put it in the first page of Ms. Schindelman's brief of $3,597,000. It is not the value for this lot for 2020 cycle. That's the balancing figure. Balancing figure and the value is something different. It's something different. Ms. Schindelman knows the detail how we came up the balancing figure. Because it's totally internal. We discuss everything before we do the refund. We all know this is not the value for this property for 2020. This value for this property is as the Thousand Taylor is $40,229,000. That's my rebuttal. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Diane or Justin, do you have anything in questioning for the assessor?
Yeah, could you point me to your rebuttal? You said you were putting where we had committed to a site plan or sewer flows. Could you point me to where that is?
No, I'm not talking about any sewer flows. I'm talking about the setback for the railway lines. Page number two.
Which presentation?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, page number two, you are not showing anything for the railway setbacks, but as per the department plan, you can see orange line, that orange line after the railway setback.
Sorry, This is the very first page.
I'm presenting very first page for the page number two. Page number two, I think initial concept plan, but the detailed plan is showing the railway setback.
Which document first?
The last one.
Rebuttal three?
Rebuttal evidence number three.
So nothing that you're presenting in this rebuttal then refers to the sewer. It's just on rail setback?
No. Because this is for rebuttal, whatever the presented by today. Because page number two, master plan, does not showing for the railway lines, but my rebuttal number three, first page showing. When we calculate the 488,762, we consider the railway setbacks.
So that 488,762 square feet doesn't include the rail setback.
Yes, that's right.
How big is that rail setback?
I don't know. I think whatever the GIS technician create those ones, they consider those ones. I think it's a 30 meter setback. I believe so. This is how I really wanted to show that the city department plan for the Thousand Taylor is the orange lines. We consider railway setback. That's all I need to consider in this my first page.
Okay. I don't think I have any other questions.
Diane, do you have any questions?
I guess just one question. So just to confirm, you did not consider the sewer issue in any of your valuation?
For this one, because I do the averaging value and I remove I give the consideration for the hydro lines. So I give some consideration of reduction of the per square foot rate, $14.50, considering everything. But my more main focus goes to the hydro line, underneath the hydro line. Those are the main concern. But the $14.50, I consider everything when we came up with this one. We consider this one vacant commercial land, Mr. Schindelman.
Okay. All right, nothing further.
Bill, do you have any questions?
I do not. Thank you.
Gail?
I have no questions, thank you.
In the master plan and what was approved by council, it does say that the redevelopment master plan included residential in that area, did it not?
It does include the residential.
Okay. I'm sorry, I got to read a little bit whilst we're going here. You gave us a lot of information to go through all at one little.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman, I know that. That's why I came to present this one. I have a long history of working with this lot.
Somewhere in your information, they talked about the sewer and said that there would be enough sewage capacity once the Colorado, that new piece was put in. I'm trying to find it now. But they said once that was in, and that's completed, is it not?
Okay, I can answer that question if you wish.
Please.
I think 1010 Taylor multifamily development, I think that area, I think Justin might know the better answer for this one. That area is not the multifamily residential area before. As his presentation also tell about the in front of the Walmart, they plan to build the CRUs, commercial CRU units. But market change, we understand market could change anytime. Market change, owner decided to build the multifamily residential, not the east side of the Walmart, but they moved that one east side from Walmart to Chen Taylor. They expedited the multifamily development. When they submit those plans, because I did not talk to planning and property development, I talked to water and waste people. Water and waste project people, they explain the owner, they notify the owner, it's going to eat up all capacity. But I think it's a process change or something. We don't know much detail about that because we don't check those information. Process change or there are stages change. That's what effect for this one. That's what I assume. That's what I understand talking to owners, talking to the people. That's what I understand. But I don't know about what was their original plan. But I know original build is a Walmart they built, Scotiabank they built, and also one apartment multi-family unit built. The 1010 Taylor multifamily unit is a very recent public takeover. I think that caused most of the trouble. That's what my knowledge is. I could be wrong. If it's not the process, Justin can explain.
Because the master plan includes the entire portion of properties, including all the way up to Pemina, correct?
Yes, that master plan included everything.
It did include everything. That's what I'm seeing. But you were trying to put across that he couldn't, this land was still as valuable today, but you're trying to say that he's devaluing it by putting up the other concept, by putting up the housing.
I did not get that question, Mr. Chairman.
Are you telling me that he has put himself in that position by putting up the apartment blocks for 248 units?
I don't know about the 100 exact the number, how many apartment units. I think when they build the apartment units in that 10 Taylor property, because then it caused the problem of the other CRUs. But still, as I heard from them, still they can build the CRUs. But it's a conflict of, I know it's a different information, but I heard from them, they are still allowed to build the CRUs at back.
Okay, I'm going to leave it at that. Is there anything in summation from your side, from the city?
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. My summation is, when we assess the properties, we have to consider those ones as the vacant commercial units. So vacant commercial lands. That's what we conclude. But meantime, we consider all the other challenges facing on this property. And considering those challenges, hydro easements, railway setback, and sewer and water capacity, today I'm making recommendation to reduce the value to 7,087,000 for this property. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Diane and Justin, anything in summation?
I think that the main thing is we have to value the land as it is. And as it is, you can't build something there. Even if you accept the city's argument that it's our fault that that's what's happened, if somebody burns down their house, you're not assessing it as if the house is still there because they burnt it down. You know, right, that you value the land. And so what we're asking is you to value this as if it is. You can't build anything on it. Maybe one day you will be able to, but certainly right now and for the foreseeable future, you can't. And fundamentally, that's how we think this should be valued on the basis of what it's worth.
Okay. Diane, have you got anything? I don't think Diane's there.
Sorry, I think that's fine.
That's fine.
Other than okay, the adjustment, one thing I wanted to mention is the adjustment for all the problems is only a couple dollars a foot, which is not enough.
Okay. You mean the city's adjustment was not
correct.
Enough? Correct. Okay. Thank you. That'll conclude that matter on number one. Number two, Do you want to just carry through, panel members, or do you want to take a short break?
Maybe just a short one for me. I need, you know, thanks.
Okay, I think we're going to take 5 minutes.
Okay, thanks.
Go make it 10.
Okay, thanks.
Okay.
We are live.
I'll call the meeting back to order. Madam Assessor, item number 2. When you are ready, it's 12:10.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. File number 22-1210. Roll number 12-0978-09140. Property owner 33462-34 Manitoba Limited. Property assets for 833,000. This is the vacant commercial land. That land area 37,850. Per square foot rate is $22 per square feet. This lot is behind the Scotia Bank, facing external road network. You will see my page number 2, where it located is facing Walmart, behind the Scotia Bank, facing internal road network. It's a corner lot. You will see the subject property photos. It's nothing built, but the flat land, nice corner. And my page number 4 showing comparables. Those comparables are for the smaller size lots. Lot sizes are on vary, but it's less than 50,000 square feet lots. You will see the per square foot rate vary from $16 to $25. It is a range. I cannot tell this one is more similar to this subject property, but it's a range. You will see the range of the rental rates. Sorry, land rates there. Page number 5, 6, 7, 8. Those are showing the comparable land lots, where it's located. And what's the size and what's the shape is the land lots. I'm not going to talk anything much here because we talk so many things. As I understand, owners would tell this also affected by the same problem with the sewerage. Yes, it is. If it's effect, yes. Then this is the part of the 20,000 Taylor lot. When we do the replat, this lot created and everything. This one does not have a railway setback issue, and this one does not have a hydro line issue. It is clear from those two issues, but unknown issue of the sewer would be there. But we consider this land also vacant commercial lot, service vacant commercial lot. Based on service vacant commercial lot, I'm asking to confirm the value as it is. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Any questions, Diane?
Just a couple questions on the comparable properties.
Sure.
Okay, on page 4, the first comparable. Is that one able to be developed?
Yes, you can see the pictures. It's already developed.
And then we'll go to the picture page 6. Is that one able to be developed? The second comparable? Can you see there's a, can you hear me? No?
I can hear you.
Oh,
yeah.
The second comparable, is it able to be developed? Was it developed?
I will ask that question from Darren, because Darren, do you know the second comparable is developed? This one?
this one here. It's an existing service station, and the other lot is bought by that company for access to that vehicle. It's like an oil change service station.
Does it have about a full block of frontage on Main Street?
It's look like it.
Yeah. Okay. And comparable number three. It looks like, does it have full frontage on a busy corner, McLeod and Gateway?
Yeah, it's, yeah.
And number four. Was that able to be developed with residential, multifamily?
Yeah, it's looked like a multifamily development is there.
And another big frontage on Marion, it looks like. Would you agree?
Do you know what the use for this one? It's
a strip mall.
Yeah, it's a strip mall. Yeah. It's a strip mall. It's all developed, already developed land.
Comparable number four is a strip mall?
Comparable number five is a strip mall. Comparable
number five, yeah.
Yeah.
Number four, okay, number five.
It's like a multi-use building I'm not 100% sure. It's by the look and the below picture.
Okay. That's fine. And number five looks like it has, would you agree, it has lots of frontage on St. Anne's Road, excellent visibility.
But it's a corner of the, very close to the end of the St. Anne's Road, Mr. Schindler.
Yeah, it's
close to the road. Yeah.
Okay, those are my questions.
Justin, any questions?
Just that you said that there wasn't any impact by hydro on this site, so I guess that didn't factor into your valuation then? Any
so, yes, this one does not, this lot is clear from the hydro lines. It does not, the plans we have, maps we have provided, it does not show anything going above this one.
Yeah. So, no adjustment for hydro then?
No adjustment for hydro, no adjustment for railway, adjacent to railway, no. But if there is a water issue, because this is a part of the 1000 Taylor property, it could be. That's something very, very unknown.
Okay, so yeah, I don't have any other questions then.
Okay. Gail, any questions?
I have no questions, thank you.
Bill?
I have no questions.
And I have no questions. On with your presentation. Whoever's going first, Diane or Justin.
Okay. One second. Okay. This property is in the same situation as the large property. It has it has the sewer capacity, which is really the worst issue here. And the situation is very similar. So I don't really have too much anything different really to present. You can see on page two of our brief, it's the little yellow vacant portion behind the Scotia Bank. So it doesn't have any frontage and the visibility is affected by the Scotia Bank. There is some easements from the hydro, not exactly on this land, but right adjacent to it. So when we're building, if we could build here, we would have to, you know, protect the hydro and all that. If you can see, the hydro easement is right along this portion to the north.
Sorry, Diane, I'm just going to, it actually, the easement does impact the south side of this property. It does have a hydro easement on it. So we'll have to be cognizant. And the issue we ran into at Scotiabank was hydro put stuff right on the edge of the easement. So we actually had to design that bank differently with a different foundation because of being adjacent to an easement. So it is relevant.
Thank you. Again, it's the sewer capacity is the same issue. And we really can't stress enough that this is a different situation than in 2000, in the last assessment cycle and the one before that, and since 2014. So it's different. You know, in April 1, 2021, we couldn't build on here. We can't build on here now. It's the same situation. I've used the same comparables again. Are they comparable? Not really. They're as close as I could find of, but it is what it is. And we've come to a value again of the same 200,000 to 300,000 per acre. And for this property, it would be 173,780 to 266,70 for the value. Justin, unless you have something, I don't have anything further.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone wants to hear from me on sewers again, so I'll defer.
Thank you.
Diane, Bill, do you have any questions?
No, I don't.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was supposed to start with the assessor. Madam Assessor, do you have any questions?
I only have one question. Okay, because I already asked many questions. Ms. Schindelman, page number one, 2020 assessment of 279,000. Aware it is not an assessment?
I'm sorry, could you say the last part? I didn't hear.
Page number one, you stated 2020 assessment is 279,000. Do you aware it is not an assessment?
Am I aware that it's not the assessment?
Yeah.
I understand how the assessment was arrived at, if that's your question.
It is a balancing number. It is not asset value. I think we discussed this one.
Yes.
Okay, that's what my question is. This is, yeah.
Okay.
That's all my question, Mr. Chair.
Okay, Gail, do you have any questions?
I have no questions.
Bill, I think I might have cut you off.
No, you're fine. I don't have any questions, though.
Now I have a question after Madam Assessor. Can you explain to me how you did the balancing to get to the 279 on the 2020 assessment?
Okay. Because this property value for 40 million, I'll go to the page now, my rebuttal brief and the page number, it's this page. Mm-hmm. I can say it in here. Because this property as a thousand Taylor is 40,229,000 worth. But the most of the value is holding by the income value of the Walmart, which is 27,934. And Ms. Schindelman and we know about when we do the valuation, we use the excess land value. When I don't have a calculation for 2020, we are talking about the 2020 value, how we derive 8 million something for the excess land. And we both agree in this lot, not the east of the Walmart. Each of the Walmart, we agreed to value of $3 per square feet. All the other areas, land value should be $13.50. That's the value we agree, land value. Then I need to do the proportioning to do the internal work to do proportioning and keep the valuation. And when we do the rebut, for dividing these ones, five lots, we discuss, for 2020 value, I agree and I promise that I'm going to keep the, I'm going to maintain the 40,229,000 valuation. I'm not going to revalue this property as a vacant land, because if I revalue the entire property for 2022, it will not be the 40 million, it will be either 50 million or either 55 million or something, because I need to use the vacant commercial land lot valuation to find the vacant commercial land lot. But we agree, we both discussed, we agree, okay, I will maintain the valuation, I will do the rebut. Then I need to do the proportioning for income valuation, which eat up the most of the valuation portion. then I have to do the proportioning to do the value docents. When I do docents, I call, we discuss and how we do these things, and we decided, okay, I will use the proportioning. Then you don't have to pay any taxes because we need to do the refund. That's how we do these assessments. That those are not the assessment, those are not the valuation. We did not value this property for 2022 when we divided those funds. This is actually, it has a negative effect to us. That's why we are here. If we just issue the supplemental valuing those funds, we might not come here and discuss those funds about this kind of 100 something issue. But we like to maintain our work relationship and we like to maintain the valuation because we go to the board of revision, we have to maintain the valuation, 40 million. That's how we got this number. I hope this explains. Thank you.
Anything in summation?
I think we're talking today. I'm asking about the valuations. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Diane and Justin, anything in summation?
Same points that we're echoing. The biggest thing is sewer issue here, and it's the same as the other item. So I don't know that we have a whole lot else to say.
Okay. Diane?
I just wanted to confirm.
Somebody's at the door.
Sorry about that. I just wanted to confirm. So there was no recommendation on this portion, this parcel?
No.
There was not.
I'm asking to confirm.
Okay. At $22 a square foot.
Yeah.
Okay.
Based on
that's all I wanted to know.
Okay. That will conclude that matter. And I do believe the next one is withdrawn. Is that correct?
Yes.
584 Wall.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Justin. Thank you, Diane.
Bye. Thank you.
Have a good day.
Catch you soon.
Thank you so much for everyone. Have a nice day.
You too. Thank you.
Now we're going to move to Altus. We're going to have to get him in and swear him in.
Where did you come from? Did you previously work for your name kind of sounds familiar? I don't know why.
Darren, no. I've been.
Are you ready to go or?
Yeah.
You want to swear Marcello in?
So, applicant, please state your full name.
Selling Martin.
Can you affirm the evidence you both present is the truth and nothing but the truth?
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I do believe it's Darren, right? Yeah, Darren, you're up first on the 170 William.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The file number is 22-1327. The rule number is 120-919-20500. The address is 170 William Stephenson Way. For the rule year 2023, with a reference date of April 1st, 2021, the assessed value is $5,667,000. The parcel use is surface parking. The land area is 61,813 square feet. And this has an outdoor parking of 231 stalls. Our recommendation is to maintain the 2023 value of $5,667,000. And Mr. Chair, I believe the applicant is in agreement for this one and is requesting confirmation. If you prefer me to go through.
What was the recommendation again?
To maintain the 2023 value of $5,667,000.
Oh, $5
million. $607,000.
Yeah. Marcello, are you in agreement with that?
Yes, I believe we actually filed documents saying that we were requesting a confirmation on that property.
Okay, thank you. Any questions from the panel members?
No questions.
No questions.
Thank you. Let's move on to the next item then. It's item number 6, 172 Donald.
Thank you. Final number is 22-1154. The rule number is 120-931-05500. The address is 252 Fort Street. The roll year is 2023 with a reference date April 1st, 2021. We have an assessed value of $4,820,000. The parcel use is surface parking. The land area is 49,183 square feet. And this has an outdoor parking of 149 stalls. Our recommendation is to maintain the 2023 assessed value. On page 2 of my brief, you'll see the aerial photos of the subject property located on Port Street, sort of steps away from Winnipeg Square, close proximity to 300 Main and the police headquarters, as well as the Jets Arena. On page 3, you'll see photos of the parking lot from different angles. This parking lot is managed by Indigo. On page 4, you'll see requests for income information. You'll see the subject sale history. We have no sales history for this property. And below that are our land sale comparables. This is a future property, so I'd like to direct your attention to the land sale comparables 1 through 6 on this chart. The comparables range from $84.78 to $136.64 per square foot. All the comparables are in close proximity to the subject property, and we believe the value of $98 per square foot is accurate. On page 5 for the Municipal Assessment excerpts. And then page 6 through 18 are the income and expense information that was mailed to us. And on page 19 through 21 are the actual details for the subject property. We see the actual monthly revenue charged on this lot was $195, $210, and $250. Applying an expense ratio of 50%, we're looking at about $125 per stall. And based on what they're actually charging, so I think the value of $98 per square foot that we've applied here is reasonable. And that would conclude my presentation.
Marcello, any questions?
Yeah, I do have some questions. So in terms of 242 Hargrave, this is also, excuse me while I just expect my documents here. 242 Hargrave, this is 225 Carlton Street. It was a large scale development by True North. It's got a wonderful configuration in terms of its location and its basic shape. And you know that it became the True North development. Did you look further into that sale?
It's according to our records, it is an arm's length sale. Yes, it was purchased. It's an older property. Or an older sale at 2016, but it's according to our records, an arm's length sale.
And so what do you think is the highest and best use of this property?
In this case, they developed the property, and basically any service parking is sort of an interim parking use that, you know, would ultimately serve for development purposes.
Yes, and what exactly does that mean? I mean, properties transition, parking lots. I can you know, I'll give you examples of parking lots that have been transitioning for 70 years. So how long is that period exactly?
Well, in this case, this would suited for development purposes. The highest and best use was for development.
You're talking about 242 Margaret?
Yeah.
Okay. And that would be for 172 Donald Street as well?
172 Donald Street. Well, it was bought as its current use is as a parking lot.
And there's no plans that you know of that suggests that there is a likelihood that this property will be developed in the near future?
No plans that we're aware of that at this present time, no.
Okay. So then currently the highest and best use is its current use, which is parking.
Not according to our models. You know, parking has really taken a hit since 2020 or since COVID, since the last cycle. Offices have been closed. Retail have been closed for long stretches, and it's deferred to the development potential of these parking lots.
Okay. So when you look at the highest and best use of the property, you're looking at potential for its change into something else, correct? And you're looking at whether it's physically possible at this point, nobody but in that, economically feasible, whether there is a market for it. You're going to run those tests to see whether there is actually demand for the construction of another building downtown, correct?
I agree, yeah.
Okay. Have you done that?
I haven't done that personally.
Okay. Thank you. Those are my questions.
Gail, do you have any questions?
I have no questions, thank you.
Bill?
Yes, on page four, your land sale comparables. So do all of these currently have, are they park surface parking, these vacant lots, these comparisons?
The first six, they all are except for 242 Margaret Street, which is True North Square.
And the 7 to 10 are just vacant commercial?
I was more focused because this subject property is so large. That's what my was focused on for these subject properties. I believe those are as well still parking lots or vacant commercial lots. Sorry.
So based on your argument about the parking lots maybe not being as viable as they used to be, then you would also have to agree that these would also, their highest and best uses would be development as well?
In general, I would agree, yes.
Okay.
For properties downtown that are limited supply. Yes.
Okay. Okay, no further questions.
Gail, did I ask you?
Yes, you did. I have no questions. They've been answered. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm good as well. Marcello, if you'll do your presentation then.
Yeah. Hey, this is 172 Donald Street. If you turn to page six, you can get a better idea of the location.
What'd you say this one was?
172 Donald Street. Sorry, which one are we doing? 252-4. I'm on the completely wrong property.
Try 252-4. Yeah, that'll make it.
252-4.
Thank you.
Okay, so this is on the corner of Graham and Fort. You can see a picture of it on page six. That's 47,000 square feet. Highest and best use is considered its current use. On page 10, we have the breakdown of the income and expenses over 3 years. we stabilized the net operating income at $204,299. We've given this property a 5% cap rate, giving us an indicated value of $4,085,980 or $4,086,000. Obviously, we've taken into consideration the other uses, potential uses of this property. Given the demand for parking, we also note that we don't see this property converting anytime soon. So we would question anybody who says that the highest and best use of this property is anything other than parking at this point. We do have some rebuttal. And I don't know if you want me to present that now or later.
You can present it now.
Okay. So regarding the sale of 124 Bannatyne, and Bannatyne is a kind of a unique property. It did sell for a higher amount. It has continued to be sold. It has continued as a parking lot. If you turn to the third page on that document, it is the sales question. Do you have this?
I don't.
Oh, and we don't have it here.
It's on the city's presentation.
Oh, the sales questionnaire?
Is it not?
Yeah, it's right now. We'd be here.
I'm okay.
No, this property wasn't. It's a sales comparable.
Okay,
we sent in the.
The rebuttal is distributed, and then you print the copies for you.
Thank you.
Has it come out yet, or?
Yeah, it's listed under item 5.
Under item 5?
Yes.
There's two? Is there two documents?
Three of them.
Okay.
Which one are we dealing with, the first one or the second one?
Rebuttal one is the sales, and then the other, I left them how you label them for patterns.
Yeah, so the second one is the sale. The first one is the sales questionnaire. And if I'll give you time to scroll to page 3 of 3 on that one. Do you have that one?
I'm looking.
Just tell me when you have it.
I'm trying. 1, 2, 3. Page 3, sales questionnaire. Got it. Anybody else got it?
I haven't got it yet. Yeah. Just sent in 9 minutes ago, is that right?
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
This in regard to the 124 Bannatyne?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, applicant rebuttal.
Yep.
Okay, item 5, applicant rebuttal. Got it.
Yep. Page 6. Okay, go ahead, Marcello.
Okay, so the first thing that we note on this questionnaire is on page 3 of 3, where they see that the purchase price was based on the property's, was the purchase price based on the property's net operating income? Yes. Now, that's an important statement because what it's telling us is that they are buying it for the income potential of that property. Now, this doesn't help my argument in terms of that property, but what I would like to say about that sale is that it is very specific to the East Exchange District where there is a lack of parking. So why we see a higher price per square foot on that property
Well, first of all, it's based on the income in that property, but at the same time, it is reflective of the demand for parking in that specific area of the East Exchange. And we note that the city's model actually stratifies the city into several areas. So the downtown areas is a little bit different than the East Exchange, or we believe we stratify it differently. And you can see that in our market study as to how we stratify the property differently. So there is a East Exchange, a West Exchange, downtown center, and then there are the outskirts of the city. So yes, it is reflective of the income potential of that property, which was high, but the value is also reflective of the rates that are in that area, which are about $30 per stall higher than in the downtown area where our subject is. So on average, the East Exchange does perform a little bit better than other parts of the city. However, this goes back to my argument of that we look at the income approach to this property. And we also note that anytime we have a building associated with a parking lot in the downtown, the assessor also uses the income approach on those properties, those surface parking lots. So it is kind of a mishmash of, you know, where they apply land and where they apply income. However, we've always stuck with the income approach because we believe it's the highest and best use is parking. So that's my presentation. Thank you.
Darren, do you have any questions on his presentation and his rebuttal?
No question.
No questions. Gail, any questions?
I have no questions.
Bill, any questions?
I have no questions. Thank you.
Okay, now we're going to go to where Marcello wanted to go, and that was that 172 Donald.
Okay, I have a summation.
Oh, summation? Okay, I'm sorry. Let's go in summation on the number five. Darren?
Thank you. Just for the $85.27 that was applied, I feel is much too low. Our department, as I mentioned earlier, found large parking lots downtown were greatly impacted by COVID from last cycle to this cycle. As I mentioned previously, people working from home more often, offices and businesses were closed for long stretches. But the value of the parking lots, as well as other parking lots downtown, have maintained their development potential. The properties are large, so this property is large, the others as well. They're located on main thoroughfares. They're in great locations. They're in limited supply. They're on corner lots. And land values have gone up. It's generally known the cities have too much surface parking and that the city wants to revitalize the downtown and increase its density. And one way to do that would be to develop these surface parking lots. So notwithstanding those reasons, the assessed value that we have applied this property at $98 per square foot is supported by the land sale comparables that I presented here today. Thank you.
Marcello, do you want to make a summation as well?
I do. So if you build it, they will come is not the way that proper planning occurs. So there has to be demand for construction of new apartments, new office buildings downtown. And the assessor noted in his first few comments in his summation that the pandemic affected parking in the downtown. Clearly, it affected office and parking as they are both related. What I'll also note is that the assessor has no sales that go beyond 2019. And what we know after 2019 is that we were hit by a pandemic. Now, there were certain projects that were already in line that had received approval, and that's why they continued on. But beyond that, demand has fallen in every area of office. So to say that there is ample demand to construct new apartments or offices downtown, I don't think is correct. The pandemic had a huge shift on the way that we work, and it had a huge effect on parking. As a note, I'll just say that many of the parking lot owners that I spoke to had, you know, basically told me that they had to write down their assets because they'd never seen this type of, you know, loss in income in the past before. Whether they can be converted, that's another question. That is a question that has to be answered by doing a proper market analysis and market summary of the highest and best use of the property. It's not enough to just say a statement and say that, yes, that's likely what's going to happen, because there's no indication that any of these properties are going to be converted in the near future.
Thank you. That will conclude that matter. Now we'll move on to item number 6 at 172 Donald.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This file number is 22-3141. The roll number is 120-933-780-00. The address is 172 Donald Street. For the roll year 2023, with a reference date April 1st, 2021, we have an assessed value of $4,003,000. The parcel use is surface parking. The land area is 36,474 square feet. And this has an outdoor parking of 116 stalls. Recommendation is to maintain the 2023 assessed value. On page 2, you'll see aerial photos of the subject property on the southwest corner of Donald Street and St. Mary Avenue, in close proximity to City Place Shopping Center and the Jets Arena. On page 3, you'll see photos of the parking lot from different angles. On page 4, you'll see the request for income information. Below that, you'll see the subject history. And then below that, you'll see the land sale comparables for the subject property. As previously stated, the subject property is 36,474 square feet at $109.75 per square foot. The property is a larger property, so again, I'd like to direct your attention to the land sale comparables 1-6 on this chart. The comparables range from $84.78 to $136.64 per square foot, and go in order from newest sale to the oldest sale. If I could direct your attention back to page 2 of my brief. If you look at that larger aerial photo at the top of the page and look directly across Donald Street from the subject property, there's a large parking lot. It was previously 2 parking lots, and they sold in 2020 for a combined value of $6 million or $220 per square foot. Now, I didn't include that because in my comparables, because it is somewhat of an outlier. But in this case, for this property, I thought it would be appropriate to show what properties, well, in a well location could sell for. So we believe the value of $109.75 per square foot is accurate. On page 5 are the Municipal Assessment Act excerpts. Page 6 through 22 again show the income and expense information that was mailed to us. And then on pages 23 and 24 are the actual in-part details for the subject property. The actual monthly revenue charged on this lot is $190 and $200. So I think that the value of $109.75 per square foot we've applied is feasible. Thank you.
Marcello, any questions?
Yes. I noted that the assessor actually had mentioned the property across the street that sold. Now, have you driven past this property lately?
No, maybe you don't.
Okay. So if you drive past it, you'll note that it was actually, it's been under construction for a while. They are, I'm not sure exactly how many stories, but I think it's somewhere around 10, between 10 and 15 story mixed use development. And it was in the works prior, I believe, even to the sale happening. So I would say that that was based on another use altogether that was realized. And it also happened prior to the pandemic. So I wouldn't say that that sale was appropriate to mention.
Marcello, are you getting to a question?
Oh, sorry. Was that sale reflective of its parking value?
I couldn't say. I don't know.
Okay, thank you. In terms of some of your other sales, I think we can agree that some of the smaller sales are probably not really reflective simply because of the size differential, right?
Absolutely. That's why I asked to focus on 1 through 6, yes.
So, and then we have two sales that are in the East Exchange District, which, again, I believe it's market altogether. Pioneer Avenue, do you know anything about that property sale?
About the property sale itself? Yes. I mean, it's between unrelated parties. Yeah, it was sold by a private individual, sold to Pioneer Artists, who are developing the tower.
So would they have been motivated to purchase this property simply because of the construction of, I believe it's 300 Main Street?
I'd agree that they'd be motivated, but at the same time, they are a knowledgeable buyer, and I don't think they'd have paid a significant amount over above what they would have to for in terms of the market.
Well, if you need to get parking and that's the only available parking, then you're motivated, right?
Yeah, I agree they're motivated, but okay. They are knowledgeable.
Okay, that's my question. Thank you.
Gail, do you have any questions?
Just in regards to the sample, the historic sales in your document, there was one in 2009 for $1,014,000, and then the March 2003, $47 million. Like, just wondering, were these sales open market, and the huge variance? Like, can you tell me why?
I'm sorry, I don't know the specifics behind those sales there. No. I would imagine one would be a multi-role, but I can't confirm.
Okay. Okay. Those are my questions. Thank you.
Bill?
I have no questions. Thank you.
And I've got no questions. On with your presentation, Marcella.
Okay. This is 172 Donald Street. Again, this is across from that parking lot that we were just speaking about. So it is a large parking lot. It has remained as parking because it serves the downtown area. This parking lot is always, you know, close to full during the day, so there's no lack of demand for it. So we valued it based on what we think is highest and best use, which is parking. Now, in terms of the income and expense statements that we looked at, part of the problem with this property is that some of the way that the client reports the income is different than it was before. So we have actually only used 2017 and 2018 to stabilize the numbers. Now, we know that obviously the pandemic had an effect on the way that properties performed. But in terms of the income that we're relying on, we chose 2018 as the best indicator. So we used $338,220 as effective gross and 49.9% expense ratio. That is $168,817. Give us a net operating income of $163,409. And a 5% cap rate to that. So that gives us an estimated value of $3,388,060.
Any questions, Darren?
No questions, no.
Any questions, Gail?
I have no questions. Thank you.
Any questions, Bill?
I have no questions. Thank you.
In summation, Darren.
Yes, please. It's just in regards to the cap rate the applicant's using, I'd like the board to know, I believe 5% is at the upper sort of limit range to what we've seen. Parking lots don't sell often, but when they do, we've seen from ranges 3 to 5%. 5% is getting into a range that's close to approved properties that depreciate. So it doesn't necessarily make sense for parking lots with little, if any, depreciating assets to have a cap rate that would be close to improved properties. Thank you.
Marcello, anything in summation?
I think in summation, I think the income is probably a very good indicator of how this property performs and how it would exchange in the marketplace. Again, there is no indication that this property is being contemplated for development. And certainly, I think given the location, we know why it has remained parking for so long. That said, in terms of the capitalization rate argument, we put a standard 5% cap rate on most parking lots in the downtown area. And we move it outside, as we move outside of the downtown to the outskirts, we adjust it to 5.25. However, given that this property location is within the sports and entertainment district, I forget the shed, yeah, sports, hospitality, and entertainment district, I would be okay with an adjustment of 25 points downward to 5.75. In looking at the presentation, that's probably one thing that I would agree on with the assessor is the capitalization rate in this area would probably be closer to 4.75 for this location. Because it is so strategically close to MTS Center and downtown shopping. That's my summation.
Thank you. That will conclude the matter on number 6. We'll move to item number 7, which is 0 Edmonton Street. Let's get it open before we go, okay? Oops, I just closed everything. Gotta start over again. I'm sorry. Hit the wrong button. Number 7. When you are ready, Darren.
Thank you, Mr. Sessor, or Mr. Chair. Sorry. The file number is 22-2638. The roll number is 120-936-0750. The address is 0 Edmonton Street. The roll year is 2023 with a reference date April 1st, 2021. And we have an assessed value of $3,269,000. Parcel use is surface parking. The land area, 29,785 square feet. And we have 104 outdoor parking stalls. Recommendation is to maintain the 2023 assessed value. On page 2, you'll see the owner of the subject property on Edmonton Street. Has exposure to the same area as well. It's right across from the RBC Convention Center. On page 3, you'll see photos of the parking lot from different angles. This parking lot's managed by InPark. On page 4, you'll see the request for income information. Below that, you'll see the subject sale history. And then we have our land sale comparables below that. As mentioned, the subject property is 29,000. 785 square feet at $109.75 per square feet foot is what we've applied. It is a larger property, so the top 6 comparables would be more appropriate. All these comparables are in close proximity to the subject property, and the comparables range from $84.78 to $136.64. So we believe the value of $109.75 per square foot would be accurate. Page 5, the Municipal Assessment Act, excerpts again. Page 6 through 12 is the income and expense information that was mailed to us. And then on page 13 and 14 are the actual in-park details for the subject property. The actual monthly revenue being charged on this lot is $220 per square, or sorry, $220 monthly. So we believe the value of $109.75 per square foot is reasonable. Thank you.
Questions? Marcello?
I don't have any questions on this one.
Hey, Gail, any questions?
I have no questions.
And Bill, any questions?
I have no questions. Thank you.
Okay, and I've got no questions. Marcello, on with your presentation, please.
Actually, we'll be asking for a confirmation on this one.
You're asking for confirmation on this one.
Yes.
Said that at the beginning. That was number 7. Darren, when you're ready on, let's get it over first, please. Give me 1 second. Item number 8. When you're ready, Darren.
This file number is 22-2627. The roll number is 12097788900. The address is Kennedy Street. Roll year is 2023 with a reference date April 1st, 2021. We have an assessed value of $2,651,000. This is a surface parking lot. The land area is 24,150 square feet. And this has 83 outdoor parking stalls. Our recommendation is to maintain the 2023 assessed value. On page 2, you'll see the aerial photos of the subject property with exposure to St. Mary Avenue. It's in close proximity to the RBC Convention Center and the Winnipeg Clinic next door. It's also in close proximity to Portage Avenue and Memorial Boulevard. On page 3, you'll see photos of the parking lot from different angles. On page 4 are the requests for information. Below that, the subject sales history and then the land sale comparables for the project, for the subject. The subject property is 24,150 square feet, and we've applied $109.77 per square foot for the property. Again, somewhat larger property. And again, 1 through 6 would be the more comparable properties. They're all located in close proximity to the subject. The comparables range from $84.78 per square foot to $136.64 per square foot, and we believe the value of $109.77 is accurate. Page 5, the municipal assessment app excerpts. Page 6 through 13 are the income and expense information that was mailed to us. And on page 14 and 15 are the actual details for the subject property, with the actual monthly revenue being charged on this lot at $190 per square foot. So I think the value of $109.77 that we've applied is reasonable. Thank you.
Marcello, questions?
Okay. These are the same sales that you've used for your other properties, correct?
Yes.
Okay. So I have no questions regarding those sales. Do you know when these pictures were taken for these homes? March 31st, 2021, on page 14. Before this is turned on.
Do I know when the pictures were taken?
Yeah, no, I realize that it says 3/31/2021, so it's good. The rate there, $190, you're aware that that is the per monthly stall rate, correct?
Monthly stall rate, correct.
Okay. And that is a gross rate, correct?
I was not aware of that.
Okay, so that's as far as I need to go. Thank you.
Gail, any questions?
I have no questions.
Bill, any questions?
I have no questions.
And I have no questions, so on with your presentation, Marcello.
Okay. So So for Zero Kennedy, if you look at the picture on page six, this is close to the Winnipeg Clinic or adjacent to it. Again, this is starting to get outside on the outskirts of the downtown proper. Turn to page 10, you can see the income approach. So again, we've gone with the income approach. We've used 3 years and stabilized. In terms of the pandemic, you can see that the pandemic has affected the earning potential of this property. However, that has gone forward and has continued. So this is this argument of whether this will continue for the near future, or this is whether, or whether this is a systemic change that has occurred. We don't know at this point. So we have given the 2020 year some emphasis. So when we stabilized it at 180,000. Obviously the 2020 had 148,200. And this is where I'll get into the issue of rents for the properties. So parking rents in general, just to explain, are always gross, and you have to net them out. Now the city's model, when you see them use the approach, actually nets that out. And what you see is only a net operating income per stall. So that's exactly what we're doing here, but we're basing it on the actuals. And in terms of the expenses, we've used a 42.8%. So if you look at my my parking stuff, note that the expenses generally are around 45%. That's what I've said. So this is quite close to that. It's given us a net operating income of $102,888. We've given it a capitalization rate of 5%. That gives us a value of $2,057,760, or rounded to $2,058,000. And the remainder of the report is just the inclusion of the income expenses that were included in the property review. And I'm open for questions.
Darren, any questions?
Yes. Looking at page 10 of your brief. Mm-hmm. Looking at the year 2020, the effective gross income at 148,200 is the exact same as total expenses at 148,200. So now if I go to the next page, 11, the actual expenses are $123,310. So that $123,310 should be the actual of the total expenses.
Actually, you're right, yes.
And then so that would be to a 2020 net operating income, like is zero, but that wouldn't be accurate. Would you agree?
No, I agree.
So given that, would you believe the stabilized net operating income you provided here is not really reliable?
I can probably do the calculation if you'd like. Correct it. It would take me about less than 5 minutes.
Sounds like a good idea to me.
Okay.
How about we take 5 minutes while she's doing that?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's take a 5 minute break.
We are live.
Call the meeting back to order. And Marcello, you said you had some numbers you had to change.
Yeah. So if you look at the next page over on the, page 10 is the income workup. On the next page over, you'll see the 2020 income and expenses, right? So that actually should be 148,200 for income. As you can see, it's 148,200 on the next page. So that average of 2017, 2018, or 2019, 2020 is actually correct, 195,340. And we've adjusted it. We've stabilized it at 180,000. Would you agree?
No, sorry, kind of lost that.
Okay, so if you, so here is the income for that year, 148,200.
Okay.
And if you turn here to page, next page over,
yep,
148,200 as the total income. Okay.
Yep.
Okay. So the issue is on the expenses.
Right.
And right. Okay. So the expenses add up to 123,310.
Right. And
right. And so when you average those out, that comes out to about $99,905 instead of $108,202 in terms of the total expenses. Okay. Now, in terms of net operating income, if we take away, if we're looking strictly at the averages and not the the actual for that year, what we get is an average of 94,602 on the net operating income. Now that's actually not that far apart from 87,138 that was averaged out there. And it's actually, I mean, it's really not that far apart from there. What I would take from this is that, you know, we're not relying as much on that specific year. So in the end, it kind of balances it itself out simply because of the differences in net or in gross income. That's what the real issue is. The gross income fell so much, so you weren't left with very much in terms of the net operating income. But in the end, we're not really taking that, you know, that income into account. So we're obviously inflating that value. But in the end, I mean, when you stabilize it, it's still, I think, fairly close. So I don't know if you really need to do much of a change to it.
Darren?
No questions. No further questions.
Gail?
So you're, if I understand what you're saying, is you're not proposing changing the net operating to 94,602, or you are proposing changing it to 94,602 at a 5% cap rate?
No, we'd be lowering it at that point, and I don't think it's necessary.
Okay. Okay. So you're proposing just stay with original number that you proposed,
yeah,
of 2,057,760.
That's right.
Okay. Thank you.
Bill?
I have no further questions.
Bill?
No questions. Thank you.
And I've got none in summation, Darren?
No, I don't. Thank you. No, thank you.
You're good. Marcello, anything in summation?
I thank you.
And I do believe that concludes everything then. We have heard all the items scheduled and this hearing is now adjourned. Thank you, Darren.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a good day.
You in the office? Sorry.